Simon & Schuster Audio presents Black Privilege. Opportunity comes to those who create it. Written and read by Charlamagne Tha God.
This book is dedicated to the state that made me great, South Carolina. The 843, the 803, and the 864. To every dreamer living on a dirt road somewhere, this book is for you. In my story, may you find the inspiration to create your own greatness. This book is also dedicated to my mother, Julie, my father, Larry, and my late grandmother, Rosalie Ford. The foundation of who I am came from the three of you. I don't know if y'all even want to take credit for my madness, but guess what? You have no other choice. Last but certainly not least, this book is dedicated to my rib, my wife, Mook Mook, and our two beautiful daughters, A and Z. Yes, the name of one of my daughters starts with an A and the other starts with a Z. We will fill in the rest of the alphabet at a later date. Please, when you two are old enough to read this book, don't judge your father for the sins of his past. I used to be a young savage, but I'm grown now, and I hope this book will remind you that life is about constant evolution. Introduction. Let me tell you about the first time I started living my truth. I was 15 years old and living in Moncks Corner, South Carolina. If you're not familiar with Moncks Corner, it's a small town of less than 8,000 people, about 30 miles north of Charleston. For most of my teenage years, my family lived in a double-wide trailer on a dirt road on the edge of town. My mother was a high school English teacher and a Jehovah's Witness, a straight-laced woman who did everything by the book. My father was her polar opposite. A contractor who was an occasional drug and alcohol abuser and a full-time hustler. One of my favorite activities back then was to talk on the phone. Not a cell phone either, but an old-fashioned landline. If you think sexting is better than talking, you don't know what you're missing. I can honestly say that 90% of the times I got pussy as a teenager was because of phone conversations, especially the late-night ones. My trouble started one night when I was on the phone with my friend Amani. By the way, names have been changed to protect the guilty, the easily embarrassed, and those who want to come up by suing me. I don't think I ever wanted to fuck Amani. Not that I would have turned it down if the opportunity presented itself, but we would just talk on the phone for hours for no reason. That night, the conversation turned to a guy we knew named Darnell, who was Amani's cousin, Deja's baby daddy. "Man, Darnell thinks he's hard," I offered. "Oh, you think he's soft, drawled Amani?" "Maybe he is, maybe he isn't," I continued. "All I know is my father always tells me the dudes who act hard in this town all end up one of three ways. Broke sitting under a tree, in jail, or dead." After that, the convo probably turned to something more pressing, like who was the best member of the Wu-Tang Clan. Neither of us gave my little rant about Darnell any more thought. A few days later, after smoking weed, I decided to go visit my neighbor Charles, who lived at the top of our dirt road. Charles wasn't home, but as I was walking out of his yard, Darnell and his cousin came driving by. They spotted me and quickly pulled over, skidding to a stop in a cloud of dust and pebbles. "Yo, Larry, what's good?" Darnell yelled menacingly as he hopped out of the car. Leonard is my government name, but people in Moncks Corner call me Larry after my father. I had zero idea what Darnell was yelling about. Number one, I was high. Number two, I talked shit about everyone in those days. I must have had a quizzical look on my face because Darnell quickly filled me in. "You was talking that shit to Amani," he announced. "So we got to fight." I'd said what I said, so there was no need to cop a plea. "Yeah, what about it?" I answered back defiantly. But Darnell was already done talking. He unleashed a wild roundhouse that would have knocked my head off, but thankfully missed. I managed to land a quick jab in retaliation. It seemed like he barely felt it. Despite being basically the same size as me, in one quick move, Darnell scooped me up, lifted me over his head, and viciously pile-drived me into a ditch. If someone had taped it, we could easily get 20 million views on Worldstar with that footage today. I tried to get up, but Darnell was already beating me back down. Punch after punch after punch after punch. Then he moved on to a chokehold. Now, in my experience, there are two kinds of chokeholds. One, the "I'm just letting you know things can get real, so don't play with me again" type. And two, the "this situation is so real that I'm going to choke you until you die" type. I'm pretty sure option number two was being administered to me in that moment. Thankfully, his cousin stepped in before Darnell could finish the job. "Chill, man, that's enough," he said, pulling Darnell off me. "Let the dude go." Darnell relaxed his grip, and I could breathe again. Though I'm sure there are some folks today, Bow Wow, Sierra, and Birdman, to name but a few, who would pay good money to go back in time and tell Darnell, nah, choke him a little longer. Think I'm exaggerating when I say Darnell was trying to kill me? Well, several years later, Darnell did kill my cousin's mother by putting her in one of his chokeholds and snapping her neck. He's serving a life sentence for it today. At the time, of course, I didn't know I'd been in the grasp of a killer. I was more concerned that I looked like I'd just gotten into a head-on collision with a Prius. I didn't want anyone to see me with my face bruised up. So once Darnell and his cousin drove off, instead of going home, I limped across the road and crawled into a vacant trailer we used to live in. Sitting on the floor with all the shades pulled dark, I started crying. Ashamed that I'd been beaten so badly. Not to mention afraid of what my father would say when he saw me. Get the fuck out of here, he told me after I tried telling him someone accidentally slammed the door in my face. You think I'm stupid? Once I got over the shock of what had happened, I started feeling better. After a while, my tears even turned into laughter. How could I not laugh at myself? I looked like Martin after he tried to box Thomas Hitman Hearns. I literally had a knot on my head so big a doctor would eventually have to shave it off. I was happy because I sensed that I'd entered a new stage in my relationship with the truth. Most people would have walked away from a beating like that thinking, I really got to start watching what I say. I had the opposite reaction. If I just survived that, there was no way I was censoring myself at all. One of my favorite songs at the time was Notorious B.I.G.'s Unbelievable, where he rapped, if I said it, I meant it, bite my tongue for no one. Sitting there in the trailer, I could hear Biggie's lyrics over and over again in my head. And his words, I'd found my own voice too. Bite my tongue for no one was the mantra I was going to live by. If I had something to say, I was going to say it. If someone wanted to know what I'd said about them, I'd tell them to their face. What's the worst that could happen? I'd get beat up. I just survived a 5-star ass kicking. If that was the worst that could happen, I was all right with it. By the way, do you know they let prisoners on Facebook now? I didn't. And the other day I got a friend request from Darnell. When I saw his face pop up on my screen, I immediately thought, no, he's out? And almost had a heart attack. When someone beats you like that, you never get over it. Bite my tongue for no one. Throughout my years as a radio guy, first on local stations in South Carolina, later as a co-host on Wendy Williams' show, then as the host of my own show in Philly, and eventually as part of The Breakfast Club, the syndicated radio show I host on New York City's Power 105.1 with DJ Envy and Angela Yee, I've been asked, not to mention threatened, to watch what I say more times than I can remember. I've been hated on for my honesty, fired for my honesty, even punched in the side of my head for my honesty. But I've never for a second doubted that honesty is not only my best friend, but also my secret weapon. Almost 20 years later, my tongue remains unbitten. Perhaps the best example of the depth of my commitment to honesty is the first time I interviewed Kanye West on The Breakfast Club. To give you a little context, the interview happened while he was out on tour supporting his Yeezus album, which I thought wasn't up to his usual standards. To make matters worse, Kanye had been delivering long rants about how the fashion industry wasn't giving him a fair shot, how he was a genius, but no one in power in the industry understood his vision, how he felt like a slave to major corporations. In my eyes, instead of trying to keep up with the Kardashians and worrying about whether an editor at Vogue liked his blouses, Kanye should have just focused on what made us love him in the first place, compelling, heartfelt music. I knew that as long as he was connected to the people via his music, all his other dreams and aspirations would eventually fall into place. In order to get him back on track, at the end of the day, I am a Kanye fan and want him to succeed. I started calling him Kanye Kardashian to poke fun at his new image. I also named him Donkey of the Day several times, a daily feature on The Breakfast Club where I give someone the credit they deserve for being stupid. Of course, when word got out that Kanye was coming in for an interview, the question on everyone's lips was, will Charlamagne really call him Kanye Kardashian to his face? Will he tell him Yeezus was whack? That certainly wasn't a Tina and Amin, Kanye's rep from Def Jam Recordings, was worried about when she arrived at our studio the morning of his interview. Charlamagne, whatever you do, she implored, please don't call him Kanye Kardashian. You got to understand why that's not cool. Being the pain in the ass that I am, I crushed that dream right away. Since you asked me not to say that, that's the first thing I'm going to say, I told her. Though in truth, I was always going to say it regardless. I added that little dig because I really hate when publicists and label reps ask me not to do my job. I'm here for the listeners, not the artists, and certainly not the labels. If there's something I feel listeners would want me to bring up, then that's what I'm going to do. Here's a little Radio 101. Listener benefit trumps everything else. True to my word, as soon as the interview began, I got right into it. They said it would never happen. A repeat Donkey of the Day offender, I said, as Kanye smiled uncomfortably. Kanye Kardashian. I wasn't done. As soon as the talk turned to Yeezus, I was truthful with Kanye. I didn't like that album at all. And I was a Kanye West fan, I told him. But Yeezus was whack to me. Was I being a bit of an asshole by calling Yeezus trash or by introducing him as Kanye Kardashian? Of course. But Kanye's a certified asshole himself, and he respected my honesty. Despite the rocky start, we ended up having a great conversation. The interview created so much heat that I ended up getting profiled in Rolling Stone and in New York Times. That's a lot of attention for an ex-felon from Moncks Corner with a night school diploma. And while I appreciated that people found the Kanye conversation compelling, the fact is, mainstream America was just learning what people who had been listening to me for years already knew. Every interview I do or conversation I have is rooted in honesty. Whether on the radio, on my podcast, or on TV, I'm always going to be honest. Honest about myself, honest about my opinions, honest with whomever I'm talking to. That commitment to honesty was one of my main motivations to write this book. I've lived a great life thus far and enjoyed every step of the process, the highs and the lows. I don't like to label those experiences good or bad because they're all part of one lifelong process. I've learned something from each and every one of them. I've been a bully and been bullied. I've been a drug dealer, a so-called thug, a so-called nerd. I've been to jail a few times. I've come within inches on more than one occasion of fulfilling my father's prediction for Donnell and all the other knuckleheads in our town. Broke under a tree, dead in the ground, or rotten in jail. But despite all that, to quote the great Pastor Young, a.k.a. the rapper Jesus.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.